Here's our breaking news tonight. The National Security Council's top Ukraine expert expected to testify to House impeachment investigators tomorrow that he listened in on the July 25th call and heard President Trump lean on Ukraine's president to investigate Joe Biden. He was so disturbed by what he heard and so concerned that it was damaging to U.S. interests that he reported it twice. So let's discuss now the perfect guest. I'm so happy to have the former ambassador to the UN here, National Security Advisor to President Barack Obama, Susan Rice. She is the author of Tough Love, My Story of the Things Worth Fighting For. We're going to talk about all of that, talk about your book. I'm so happy to have you here.
It's great to be with you, Don.
You can offer great perspective. Absolutely. So I want to get your reaction to the opening statement of Colonel Vindman tonight here. You've been, I'm sure, hearing about it in the news. He says he heard Trump ask Ukraine to investigate the Bidens. How damaging is this to the president?
Well, this is one in a series of corroborating testimony that, taken together, is quite damning. Mm-hmm. The interesting insight about Colonel Vindman is that he was on the phone call and that he is essentially reinforcing the testimony that indicates that there was clearly a quid pro quo with respect to both the White House visit and the military aid.
It's no different than with the readout of the call.
The most damning evidence is the president's own words. Right. But now we have everybody else validating that.
In Vindman's testimony, the colonel says he twice alerted the lead counsel of the National Security Council. What should have happened at that point?
At that point, the counsel for the National Security Council, I had a similar person reporting to me, should have taken it straight up the chain to the White House counsel, and the White House counsel should have looked into this very serious matter. And when it was referred to the Justice Department, rather than try to quash it and suggest that there was nothing there, there should have been a thorough investigation.
Mm-hmm. I want to switch gears now. Can we talk about the takedown of al-Baghdadi? What do you think of how this went down?
Well, obviously, it's a great triumph for our special forces, for our intelligence community. And we all, as Americans, ought to recognize that his passing makes us marginally safer. And it was a milestone in the fight against ISIS. But the notion that this means it's all over, that one can declare mission accomplished, is completely false, as we've learned the hard way in this part of the world time and again. We can't take the pressure off. And that's why President Trump's decision to unilaterally and prematurely withdraw remaining American forces from northern Syria is so detrimental to the fight against ISIS, mm-hmm. but also to our ability to keep Russia and Iran and Assad in check, as well as Turkey's ambitions.
Well, let's talk about the book, because you write about that in your book. And you say Trump's announcement back in 2018 to withdraw troops from Syria created a risk for ISIS to revive and reinvent itself. Is there still a risk now, even though al-Baghdadi is dead?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Baghdadi is important symbolically. He's a leader. But we've seen time and again, whether with new leadership, new names, whatever, these terrorist groups easily reconstitute. And this one was not down and out. It was just down. Mm-hmm. So we have every reason to be concerned. The Secretary of Defense has already announced that 100 ISIS captives, terrorists who had been in prison, have escaped. Somehow President Trump thinks it's more important to guard dormant oil fields than to protect the Kurds and protect our gains against ISIS. So everything is upside down here, and it's quite dangerous for our security.
And would we have been able to do this without our allies, without the Kurds?
No, it'd be very, very difficult to have the kind of actionable intelligence we needed without the Kurds.
You and I, many in the Obama administration and journalists have been on the wrong side of the president's tweets, right? And he tweets about you a lot. But you, along with folks on both sides of the aisle, have been critical of President Trump's handling of Syria. And he tweeted this, calling you a disaster for Obama and Syria. In that same tweet, he proclaimed that millions were killed. You responded by saying that back in 2015, Trump gave you a totally gross hug and said that you were unfairly treated over Benghazi.
And I was doing a great job for the country. So I responded to his tweet saying, well, if that's what you thought, why'd you say to me 2 years later I was doing a great job for the country? And why, if I'd never met you before, did you come up and give me a hug and whisper in my ear, which, as I said, was gross.
Why did you think he did it? He hasn't answered.
And he did not respond to my tweet.
I've got to ask you about this, and I know it's going to make you cringe, but I want to ask you about when you were talking about Benghazi with Pod Save America last week, you said this about Senator Lindsey Graham. And then a warning, there is some strong language here. Let's watch it.
Right, because Lindsey Graham isn't just a piece of shit now.
He's been a piece of shit.
Lindsey Graham
was. I said it. Yeah. Damn it. Yeah. Finally. Yeah. He's a piece of shit.
So I want to ask you, I mean, again, strong language. Because
my mother would not approve.
Yeah?
No, she really would she tell me. Not. No, she wouldn't approve of that.
And listen, your book ends with a call to find common cause with people you may or may not agree with. And you said that we should step back, cool off, and try again. So then, do you think that was?
No, that was an intemperate comment, but it came from a place of experience.
Yeah. And that's that's all you want to say about that. On impeachment, there's set to be a House vote this week to establish some open hearings here. Because, you know, Republicans have been complaining and saying, you know, that it's done behind closed doors. Do you think Republicans will seriously consider the witness testimony about the president's actions? Do you think they'll stick with him, or they'll continue to try to impugn all of the witness testimony, with the incredible background and service that this gentleman and others have given to this country?
It's not just the colonel, though. Well, we certainly are grateful for his service. It's a series of career foreign service officers and ambassadors who've done nothing for 20, 30, 40 years but served their country on an apolitical basis with integrity. The evidence is increasingly overwhelming. Whether that will cause Republicans in Congress to finally wake up and put country over party, I'm unwilling to predict. Yeah. But it certainly should.
What did you learn? Because you've been in the fight, right? You were there. What did you learn from writing this book? Not from being there, because we know that you have a lot of experience with that, but from writing this book. What did you learn?
Well, I learned a lot of things, but the message I want to convey through this book is twofold. One, we're living in dangerous times, and there's a way that national security decision-making is supposed to work. There's a way that we deal with difficult issues with a rigorous process. That's broken down. It needs to come back, whether we have another Democratic president or Republican president. That's really important. And the second critical message, Don, is that we're at a point of real peril with respect to our domestic political divisions, which I actually think are our most proximate national security threat. We've had periods of division before, from the Civil War through McCarthyism to Vietnam, and we've overcome them. This is a moment where we really have to decide that that's what we're about. And, you know, we have the wherewithal to do it. I lay out some very fundamental steps that we can take as individuals and as a nation, including things like mandatory national service that can bring us together. But this is a time of reckoning. And if our security is to be secured, if our democracy is to be preserved, and I think it can and it must be, then we have to recognize the urgency of the moment and come together.
Thank you. I love your candor, and I appreciate you coming on. And it was a perfect night to have you on to talk about all these issues. Ambassador Rice, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Don.
The book, again, is called Tough Love, My Story of the Things Worth Fighting For.